Expo players have been taking turns going over and getting, not a lot of them, but several of them have been going over and getting their picture taken with Andrew Jones from the Atlanta Braves. We're at Olympic Stadium on this 15th day of September 2003, and looks like the Expos want to get their picture taken with the Atlanta Braves star. We're here for the first game of a three-game series, the Atlanta Braves and the Montreal Expos.
Good to take us an hour to get here.
We flew in.
We'll try it again. Calvin Kastein at Olympic Stadium again. We're here for the final home series for the Montreal Expos, the Atlanta Braves. And when this series ends, they'll go on a road for about 8-9 games and then call it a year. And we're all hoping that we'll see them next year. As it stands now, it looks like there's a pretty good chance of that happening. I brought along with me a couple of gentlemen to help pass the time and talk sports. And all they've talked about is mid-50s high school ball, so I don't know if we're in a time warp here, but we've got Ronald Roberts and John Zurlo. And you guys were friendly opponents almost 50 years ago.
Yes, we were. In fact, we both graduated in, Ronnie was 57. But
when he graduated?
When he graduated, yeah. Good comment. No,
he did graduate.
He's not even 57 now.
Right.
But he graduated in 57. I was 56, and we played many games together, both soccer and basketball. Ronnie didn't play a lot of baseball. He had to work on his father's farm.
That's right.
But we competed, and not because Ronnie's here, and I want him to look good in front of your hometown fans and customers, but he was an outstanding basketball player, one of the best in the league in 1956. And we had some good contests. If I think back in 1956, we split two games. I don't know if you recall it. I think you won the first game and we won the second game.
Yes.
So.
Who won the first game?
I think Moores won the first game.
So we're gonna
on our court.
Okay, so we're gonna go first to the Moores game. Moores and Champlain Central, by the way. CCIL, Clinton County Scholastic League.
Yes, CCIL.
How do you remember that first game, Ron? What stands out?
The first game stands out that this John Zurlo could shoot quite well from outside of the 15-yard
foot.
15-foot.
Yeah, we didn't have three-pointers in those days.
We had three-pointers in those days, but he could shoot quite well, and they had a very good team. They were a very, very good team, and but it was good sportsmanship back then. I enjoyed playing. We competed, but yet we respected each other, and it was good.
I know you, not because you're both here, but I know you were both the stars of your respective teams. Who else was on your team, Ron?
I don't know if I was a star, but I did play back then.
He was a star.
We had Ward LaValle, Elton LaPorte.
Ward LaValle, that's the singer.
Doug LaValle's brother.
Younger brother.
Homer Miller. Elton LaPorte. Jimmy Forkey played with me up front sometimes.
Had to be a Hawksby on the
and
team.
And then Bob Hawksby played up front with me. It's a good team. Fairly good team. We're a short team. Back then, we were comparable to Champlain, about the same height, same score. And Peru had extremely. Oh.
Well, they had a boy that was 6'5", which was unheard of in the mid 50s.
Yeah.
Chuck Kinney was an outstanding player, but of course he had size, and you know when we played them, we defended them with a person that was perhaps 5'11", 5'11 and a half.
You're right.
We didn't have a 6-footer.
Neither was.
So it was tough.
Very
and that's why they were perennial winners.
Didn't he have some outstanding?
We don't want to talk about that.
We do not want to talk about
99 points against.
Well, we don't want to talk about it.
Who was it against?
It was against Champlain Central, and for your fans, Champlain Central was Northeastern Clinton. I mean, Northeastern Clinton Champlain Central.
There is another school involved in that merger of Champlain Central that made
Rogers Point.
And then Northeastern Clinton has another school district in it too.
Rogers Point and Moores, that's right. Moore. So we're all in this together.
Moores.
But what he's trying to say is that we're all in this together.
We're all in this together.
He's trying to say that Northeastern Clinton is Champlain is what he was trying to say, but we won't let him get away with that.
Do you want to tell the story or am I going to tell the story?
You tell the story.
Well, the story was, it was 1956. No, I take it back. It was 1955. And Chuck Kinney
scored 99 points.
And he, against Champlain Central.
Were you guarding?
Had nothing to do with Moores, had nothing to do with Rouse's Point. It was Champlain Central back then, before any of the mergers. Was I guarding him? No, I wasn't. I was there that night, but I was sick, recovering from the flu, and I sat on the bench next to the coach in street clothes, and I watched this brutal performance against my team. Who guarded him? I'll tell you exactly who guarded him. A fellow who was, now remember, Chuck Kinney is 6'5". The fellow who guarded him is Charlie Langley, still lives in town. Charlie was about 5'8".
Still is.
And maybe less. We're in our 60s now.
Don't keep backing up, John.
And he scored 98 points.
98.
To my recollection, and Norman Gamache, maybe some of you remember Norman Gamache, classmate of mine, graduated in 56, was a scorekeeper. And Norman was an excellent scorekeeper. He never missed a trick. And he claims that Chuck Kinney did not score 98, he only scored 88. But can you imagine in a little scorebook scoring all those points and making all those little twos, and he ran out of scorebook space, and there was a fella, Tommy LaSalle, was next in line in the scorebook, and he had scored 10 points, and Norm said they just gave Chuck every point they could and he took Tommy LaSalle's 10 points. Now that's our story.
It's quite accurate, John, because a few years ago I talked to one of the players that I'd played against, Bob Way, who played for Peru at that time.
Yeah. He was on the team that night.
And
come this way, guys.
Okay. He was basically saying that he did not score 98 points. But it was a state record for scoring that many points, and they left it stand. But from what I gathered, it is still debatable today.
Yes, it is.
Obviously.
Yeah. Bob Way told me the same story one day, running into him at one of the summer parade days.
Yes.
I forget where it was, Saranac or somewhere. And we chatted at length, and he told me this story, and he told me other things that night too that I shouldn't say.
We'll say it upstairs in the press box.
Maybe if you don't like what I have to say, you can.
I might forget.
You have a way of chopping it out. But he told me that the coach that night told everybody to pass the ball to Chuck, especially in the second half when he had maybe 40 some odd points in the first half. Says everybody will pass the ball to Chuck. And this Bob Way didn't think that was right, and he told the coach so. And the coach told him to take his uniform off and put your street clothes on, you're done. You're not gonna finish the night. And that's what this player told me, and there was another player with him that went also that didn't think that was the right thing to do. And so let's leave it at that. I mean, that was 56, 44, 47 years ago. Why are we even talking about it, right?
That's right.
Well, we're talking to two old guys. So what do we talk about? Old stuff, right?
You're probably right, Calvin.
Okay, John, we mentioned who was on your team?
Front court was myself and Bill Leach. Bill
was pretty big boy.
Yes, he was.
He
was a good player.
How come he wasn't guarding Kinney?
I don't think Bill was on the team that year. I don't think he played. This was a year before the senior year.
Yeah.
So my senior, we're talking senior year now. We had myself and Bill up front. Wayne Pettis was a center man. And in backcourt was Charlie Langley and Brian Yakey. And on the bench, we had two kids.
Rusak, was Rusak on the bench?
He was on the bench coaching. Harry was a kid. No, he was older, and he had one younger, but not on that team. Okay. And we only had two players, and Coach Rusak used to tell us, a couple of the seniors, watch the JV game very carefully. He says, we only have seven players. He says, you pick a player that you think would help us on the varsity, and we were allowed in those days to do that. We would, and Carl Smith was a JV player, and he was one of the better JV players, and we used to ask Carl to come up and sit on our bench, and he got a lot of PT on the varsity that year, and he used to always come up and play with us as well. He played on the JVs and then back on the varsity. So that's we played on the little elementary school gym, Champlain Elementary, which is now closed, much to my dismay, but it's closed. And you guys played at the Moores Elementary School.
Yeah.
Two nice little courts, very nice, and it was a warm
community.
Buildings. They really were.
And 100 people, you had a full house, and you really felt you were in the big time.
And of course, they were the high schools then. I don't know if, again, your viewers have to remember that, some of the younger viewers. Champlain Elementary was the high school. That was K through 12, as was the Moores Elementary School. That was K through 12. We were all there. There were only 9 in my graduating class. There were 65 kids in high school. We were a Class C school, but 65 kids was what we had in high school. Divide that by 4, and that's what you had for high school enrollment.
Yeah, it was a different different world. There's still schools that graduate 9, Keene, I think, Keene Central usually
Crown
has
Point
8 or 9. Well, Crown Point's a little bit bigger than that. They've been
they're in the 20s along. Now.
Well, you look at that every year, and they put out the graduates. I kind of count them to see.
there was not a large high school back those days. I mean, it was nothing to fill the auditorium. In fact, the auditorium was filled every game, and the people had to be on the outside looking in to watch the game.
I remember on the stages. On the stages, they put up a. We used to have 2 sets of bleachers for the soccer field, and we used the same 2 outdoor sets of bleachers for baseball.
Yeah.
And they came in the fall. The custodians would put those on the stage side by side, and that's where the kids would have to sit.
Yeah.
The kids that came to the games on Friday night. We only played on Friday night, very few Tuesday games, mostly only Friday, and we didn't play nearly as many games. We played like 18 or 19 games for the season. I think the kids played more now.
All they play now is 20.
Do they? But then they get into sectional play probably. We did too, but very rarely did we get into the sectionals.
Yeah, but there was no going to the state championship.
No, more, none of that.
No,
none of that.
Nothing like that.
No, they could end up playing 25, 26 games.
Yeah.
But the kids would sit on the stage, and in those days, on one side of the gym, Moores and Champlain, there were nice chairs, cushiony chairs, and that's where the adults were. That's where the adults sat.
Oh, was St. Mary's in the league then?
St. Mary's was, yes.
Now, I remember being a student at St. Mary's, and I never did it, but there would be certain guys would... The basket by the stage had this bar coming down on each side, and the fans have been known to shake it a little bit when the other team was shooting.
You know, worse than that, St. Mary's was a tough hall to play in. Way back in the 50s, St. Mary's had boarders. There was boarders that lived there. They came from South America. They came from all parts of our country. And
Montreal,
they had a good business. You know, they would educate these foreign students. And they would pay their tuition, and they would stay there the whole year. Well, when we played at St. Mary's, the nuns would march these boarders into the balcony, which is still there in the St. Mary's gym, and they would pack that balcony. And balcony would be packed, and they would lean over there, and they would be shaking things and yelling at you. It was like when you watch a professional game now, and the professional players shooting a foul shot, and behind, or colleges do it even more than the pros, waving these things. It was difficult to play in St. Mary's. It was quite a home advantage to be a St. Mary's player. St. Mary's had good teams. Yeah, they did very well. They had volunteer coaching, and some of the coaches way back, Orville Glode, Bing Glode's dad, did an excellent job.
Orville coached?
Yes, Herwood Prevost coached. Hubert Papeline coached. They had dedicated people, and they did all the sports. I remember, this is how sports have changed. St. Mary's played, I think it was Altona, in a baseball game, and they used Champlain Central's field, the one across from the American Legion. And one umpire showed up, and that was it. So Orville Glode was the coach. And I was probably a sophomore or junior in high school, played for Champlain Central. And Orville said to me, John, would you like to ump the bases tonight? This is a high school game, I'm a kid. He says, well, I said, yeah, I don't mind. So he went and told the home plate umpire, says, well, that's my base umpire right there. I umpired the base. I'll never forget this as long as I live. The first batter for St. Mary's was Altona, I remember now very distinctly. First batter was Frank Gay, Sonny Gay. Sonny hit a good shot. No, I take that back, got my story mixed up. It was a fella from Altona, hit a good shot. Sonny was the second baseman. And I didn't do this because I like Sonny and I was rooting for St. Mary's, but I blew the call. This kid beat the call and throw came in. It was a good play for St. Mary's, but a little bit late, and I called the guy out. This kid looked at me, I'll think of his name, and I knew I made a bad call, and he knew I made a bad, but he didn't say anything. He just ran off the field, and Sonny looked at me and said, well, thank goodness, you know, but I'll never forget that. I felt so bad that I made that bad call. But, you know, I guess Orville thought it was a good call. Orville was a great guy. I enjoyed him.
You talked about cheering for St. Mary's. I was never that way because I'd go to Champlain Central game and cheer for Champlain Central and cheer for St. Mary's unless they were playing each other. But that didn't happen. Most of the Champlain fans would come and cheer against St. Mary's and the St. Mary's fans would cheer against Champlain. And I imagine the same thing, especially with Rouse's Point.
Do you remember what they used to call each other? The St. Mary's kids used to call Champlain Central kids high school bums, and we would call St. Mary's students St. Mary's bums, St. Mary's bums. but we loved each other, you know, we got along fine.
We were playing the same team during the summer, but...
And I'll tell you, St. Mary's had a lot of good teams, and so did Champlain Central. You can imagine if there was a merger there way back when we were in high school, would have been some great teams. But we were picked thin. You had Moore's, a little team, Rouse's Point, a little team, St. Mary's, a little team, and Champlain Central. Well, they put them all together. But I don't want to get into that because I think once we put them all together, I thought we would be just a big powerhouse like the Yankees, but it never really happened.
It didn't work out that way.
Now,
before we started taping, you mentioned some of the people you played against. Like you were mentioning, Terry Brunell was a pretty good pitcher.
I never played that much baseball. I just a couple games because I had to end up going to work on a farm. But
with 17 Harry, brothers, Harry, how come you had to work?
Well, that was part of the
package.
Part of the package. I did play basketball and play soccer, but baseball was not. But Terry Brunell is one I can remember. Excellent pitcher for Altona. And the amazing part about it. A couple years ago, I lefty from Ellenburg that pitched was
Basil Curry.
Basil Curry, and we got to play golf together. And Basil was playing in AAA baseball.
Yes, he did.
And
excellent player.
And his catcher at that time was Joe Torre. Was catching for him.
Really?
For Basil Curry at that time. So you never know
in
life.
To Torre.
Joe Torre,
we
know he became.
He went into obscurity.
Joe Torre became the Yankees. As we know, Joe Torre became the manager of the Yankees and then left. The rest is history. So, but in high school, you never know, or in life, you never know who you're going to really. Come in contact can change your life. I truly believe sports is good for for people's character. I truly believe that. Because it's when we win, everybody's happy. But what happens when we lose? You know, you still got to lose with grace. Is win with grace. You know, it's hard.
Well, sport did something good for this fellow, because not only did he have to work hard, he learned business ethic. He learned how to work. You know what hard work is, and we're proud to have him as one of our successful Northern Tier businessmen.
Well, he could have learned to work hard on the farm, too.
Well, exactly. That's why he didn't play much baseball. That's my point. But and he's absolutely right. You know that sports teaches character. And you know, you look at a lot of successful people, and a lot of them were good athletes.
That's why you make a good Clinton County clerk.
Clinton County jerk, did you say?
Clerk. An excellent Clinton County clerk. We will not discuss parties at this time.
Well, we got to give equal time. Do you have an opponent?
I'm fortunate not to have one this year, and I certainly appreciate the other side of the aisle thinking that I'm doing a sufficiently good job not to go and dig and find someone. Certainly it's a lot easier to campaign when you don't have opposition,
too.
And a lot cheaper, yeah, no question. But I think we're doing a good job there, and certainly deserve another shot at a four-year term.
He has to do a good job, otherwise they would look for somebody. So I think you're to be commended, John. You're doing an excellent job. Otherwise, he would look for somebody.
Yeah, but he's not. If he's got one weakness, I'd say it's probably in jokes.
His jokes. Do I have to make a comment on that? Jokes.
How many jokes did I tell you on the way up here? First of all, how many jokes did I tell you on the way up here?
Probably about 15.
And how many did you laugh at?
Probably two.
It's not probably. It was probably, it was one.
Well, he's very discriminatory when it comes to humor.
Yeah, I think so.
No, but he told us one joke, and he laughed real hard at that one. Remember
yeah,
that?
Yeah, that's right. Well, see, that's... He likes his own jokes. We had him laughing one time, and it wasn't even a joke.
All right, let's get back to 50 years ago. Any other opponents that stand out that come to mind? I know tomorrow you'll think of 15 of them, but any others for Ellenberg or
players or teams?
Both.
We had for a small area. We had a lot of great ball players.
Great ball players.
One, some of the real great players, there was, of course, Warren Tesher, Lefty Tesher, who played for Our Lady of Victory, graduated in 1955, went on to St. Michael's, and starred there, both in basketball and, well, not so much basketball, because St. Mike's had great teams, and
good team.
As good as Lefty was, he never was a star there, because they had so many good players, but he was a star baseball player. And he signed a professional contract with the Philadelphia Phillies after his junior year. He was a year ahead of me, but came back and graduated with my class because he had signed and had to leave, so it took him an extra year. But he went on to play some good minor league ball, covering first base on one occasion. He got smeared by a runner and threw his shoulder out, and he never made it again. Got sent to the hospital, and the nurse that cared for him in the hospital, he married Barbara.
Is that right?
Yeah, and they just left the area again. They came back to the area, and Warren was the chief executive officer at the Evergreen Valley Nursing Home. And then he went into home health care and then retired, and they went back. I think they're living in Rochester now. He was a great ball player.
Where his kids are, so he went back.
Yeah. And it was Pete Cronin, went on to Norwich, played ball in Norwich. He was a catcher. Getting back to my Lefty Tesher story, of course, I ended up at St. Michael's. Not ended up, I went on my own choosing and loved it there. But we became battery. I was a catcher, and I caught a game for Lefty during my career at St. Michael's. And
So that was, I don't know if I ever told you the story. I guess I did.
Yes, you did.
You want me to tell that story again?
We'll see if Ron finds it funny.
I'll see if he laughs.
All right, you're on the spot here, Ron.
We were playing a collegiate game, and Ron, Lefty, was, of course, attracted all the scouts. So whenever he played, whenever he pitched, the scouts were there, three or four of them. This one occasion, Ron Northey, who played with the Cubs many years ago, was a scout for the Cubs, and he was there clocking everything Lefty did. They didn't have one of those guns. What do you call those guns?
Radar
guns to do the speed of the ball. But he had everything else, all kinds of watches, and he would clock everything. And so I came up to bat this one time, and Lefty had gone out, batted before me. He was like fourth, I was fifth. And he, long, high pop-up. And he legged that thing out, and guy clocks it, his speed. So I came up next, and I hit a ground ball to the infield. And I legged it to first base, got thrown out. So when I get back to the dugout, Ron Northey calls me over. He says, "Hey, kid, come here. He says, I want to talk to you." So, gee, I thought maybe I was going to sign a professional contract.
Sure.
He saw something, you know, saw some greatness in me. So he says, you want to know something? I said, "Yeah, what?" He says, "I clocked Lefty when he made that pop-up. He ran all the way to second base. I got so much time." He says, "You grounded out and ran to first base, and it took you the same amount of time to run to first base as Lefty did to second base." Geez, I went back, put my gear on, with my head hanging low, and I said, "There goes my professional career." So, but yeah, every school had a pretty good player. Ellenburg had a lot of good players, big kids. They had a lot of big kids. And Chazy had some great players, Gary Lawyer.
Bobby West.
Bob, the West boys were good baseball players. They were phenomenal hitters.
Yeah. Did they have a basketball team? Did they play at Champlain?
Yes, in 1956, they played in our league. Yep, they played all of their games away. They didn't play. They practiced in their little exercise gym that they had at school. This was before, of course, our new school was built, and they played all of their games away. And they had some good teams.
Very good teams.
Donald Saucer,
Gary Lawyer.
The West boys, Gary Lawyer. They had another couple of other good shooters.
Was Don Brothers around then, or that?
Don was after us.
Smokey played. Smokey was a good player. Smokey was a catcher too. Played. Was an excellent baseball player.
Lime Mountain had a team back then also.
Probably a few Polish players.
There was a few Polish players that played for Lime Mountain. It was very good. It was tough to play up in Lime Mountain because, I mean, the crowd really got involved. You know what I mean? Every call was loud. I mean, you know.
But you probably played them in non-league games because they weren't in the CCIL.
Oh, they weren't in the CCIL.
They were in, and Rouse's Point wasn't either. Rouse's Point was in I believe it was the Franklin League. Franklin Clinton County League.
Oh, okay.
And I think that Lime Mountain might have been either in that league or with the Plattsburgh.
They might have played against Chattagay.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, if I can think of those schools, back then it was Champlain and Chazy and Moores, Ellenburg, Peru, and Altona.
Altona.
That was it. 17. It was seven teams in the league. I don't know if I said seven. And we played each other twice. There must have been eight teams in the league, played each other twice, so it was 14 games. Then we played a couple of non-league games at 16, and maybe a sectional game, 17. I played 17, 18 games. But it was a lot of fun. The pressure, you know, it wasn't as organized as today. You know, it was nowhere as near the programs that the schools have today.
No.
You know, we were lucky to get eight or nine kids out for a sport, and but today it's more it's just more organized, and the leagues are better organized, the records are kept. We didn't even keep any records. I mean, back in 1956, you're lucky if the game got reported to the newspaper. But it's not like that today. More structured today.
Yeah, and it's become, you know, more interest in the general public. You always have that small crowd But, you know, maybe the average person on the street, because of the press coverage, is more aware of what's going on.
Well, you know, back in the 50s, there wasn't as much to do either. So, you went, as Ronnie said, that the gyms were packed on Friday night. But there was only one show in town, and that was going to watch the high school basketball team play.
That's right.
Yeah, but I look at those gyms, I like particularly like St. Mary's, and I remember the huge crowds we'd get there. Now I watch some fifth and sixth grade games there, and I wonder how many people were actually in here that made it look like such a huge crowd. 150 would really pack the place, you know. So in a bigger gym now, 150 looks good, but you can't compare it to the what it looked like in a small gym with a small seating.
Absolutely.
All right. What do you guys know about the Expos?
Well, certainly you can't pick up a newspaper without seeing their name someplace because of the longevity of the team, how much is left. Is this the last home series here in Montreal, or will they be back next year? Talking to some of the people that seem to be in the know here at the stadium when we arrived, they think that the team will be back next year, but you know, the future is not good for Montreal. And another thing that Ron and I noticed, that when we arrived at the administration office, looking at the plaques on the wall, where back in the early 90s and mid 90s, you know, 2.5 million, 2.6 million is what they used to put in here every year. And the fellow up in the press box was telling me, gee, there's nothing to have 50,000. He was telling me that a lot of people don't like this stadium because way back and under these overhangs, it's a long way, especially out in the left and right field, it's a long way to the batter's box, and you can't see too well. But he said back in those years, they would put 50,000 in nightly for home games. Well, if you did 2.5 million people, you got to believe it. So hopefully they'll be back. You know, their problem this year, to my way of thinking, is that they just weren't consistent enough. Of course, they lost Guerrero for 51 games with his back injury. But you know, they would win four or five in a row, then they would lose seven out of the next 10. Then they'd have to battle back to get to 500. Well, you know, that they just seem to be lacking something to let them go all the way. To me, they should have made the playoffs, but there's a lot that goes into it that I don't believe we know, or the ordinary fan knows. I think there's a lot of politics involved in this decision with Montreal, and I think that's going to lead baseball out of Montreal.
Well, I'm not going to apologize for Major League Baseball by any means, but the fact remains that Expos have been in limbo for a couple of years, and nobody from Montreal has stepped up and said, hey, I'll buy the team and keep it here. But you've got people from other cities that are working hard to make it happen in their cities. The fact of the matter is, nobody in Montreal has stepped up and said, here's an offer, we want to keep the team in Montreal. So what else can Major League Baseball do except move them?
For that reason, we're glad we have a team this year, because you and I came last year at the tail end and we didn't think we'd be back this year.
Yeah, for the last couple of years we haven't thought we'd be back. This year I'm optimistic at this point that we will be back, but I'm not too optimistic about what type of team we're going to see next year, because it's going to be without Vladimir Guerrero. I think he'll be without Levon Hernandez. Hernandez is pitching tonight. If he gets another four innings in, he qualifies for a $6 million jump in pay. They can't afford to keep him next year. They can't afford to keep Javi Vasquez, who's up for arbitration. So you're going to have a decimated team again. The attendance has been picking up. At this point, we need 12,500 to go over a million in attendance this year, which is very good compared to what's been the last couple of years. 2 years ago, it was less than 700,000. But with those stars gone, next year's attendance is just going to drop again, because who's going to come out to see a team that doesn't have their stars?
Absolutely. You can't blame the players. I mean, what is Guerrero making? I mean, $3 or $4 million? I mean, players of his caliber today are making $15 million. He's going to be gone, you know. He's not going to stay here for that, even though who needs that much to live, right? But heck, that's his value. That's his value in the market. He might as well go and get it. So, they're not. It's just like the 90s when they depleted the team. I mean, that's why when we saw the $2.5 million for 4 or 5 years in a row, the strike came and they depleted the team because they didn't want the payroll. Well, that's what happened. That was the beginning of the end.
But I think we will get one more year of Expos, but I think it's going to be a case of come out and watch the opponents, because I don't think there'll be a lot left on this team. I don't think they'll be as bad as the Detroit Tigers are this year, but...
I was just going to say that. I think the record will be better than Detroit.
But you can't take away a couple of star pitchers and a guy who gives you 40 home runs every year and not have a detrimental effect. So it'll be a far different team next year.
Yeah, without a doubt.
All right, any other thoughts? You get set to watch the game?
No.
You want to auction off a Ford?
Ford car, something like that. We could
Lincoln.
Ford, Lincoln, Mercury. Not Lincoln Mercury, just a Ford. Be good.
I thought maybe you'd give a Lincoln away to the guy who hit the first home run tonight.
He doesn't sell Lincoln.
Well, he has Lincolns on his lot. Yes, he does. Maybe not new ones, but they're almost new.
You got a nice new red T-Bird out there.
Yeah,
red. I'd make a pretty good salesman for you.
You make an excellent salesman.
Thank you.
Excellent.
We know we do all his paperwork. Every new vehicle he sells come in the office, and his paperwork is always exceptionally well done.
That's because of Jane.
Jane is just perfect. But we know that he's doing a good business.
You keep a score sheet up there?
No, we don't do that.
Oh, Robert sold another one.
Another satisfied Robert's customer.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. This is Calvin Kastein bidding adieu. We got John Zurlo and Ron Roberts, and we're coming at you from Olympic Stadium and talking about everything, it seems, except the Montreal Expos and the Atlanta Braves.
Just said it was on a straight line.
That's right. You read the rule book. You don't say nothing about your line drive being a fly ball. Infield fly. That's the case when the guy hits a line drive between the second baseman and the third baseman or whatever, first baseman, then it should be called infield fly.
Frank, did you feel it was a case of just Levan not having his best stuff tonight?
No, he had good stuff in the first half. Just like with old Levan out there, the first inning, it seemed like when he two plays that wasn't made behind him. In the second inning, when you give up a home run, it just seemed like he just could get the ball to strike him. After that.
Positive note, I guess the Shire home run at the end.
Positive note. It's a lot better. The people that were here know that it was a very good ball game.
Why does Jose Vidro continue to play? He obviously looks like he's hurting out there.
He wants to be out there. He wants to be out there. He wants to be a part of this team until it's over. If he wants to go out there and he's on one leg, I'll put him out there. If he tells me he's had enough and I want to go out there, I'm going to put him out there. I think he has earned that. And I feel like I respect that.
Thank you.
Well, I first of all, you know, I didn't hear anything when the ball hit the ground in here. I didn't hear anything before that. I thought it was a, you know, regular line drive, and the guy called it for fly. If he did it, he did it very, very quiet because I didn't hear anything. You know, it's a ball that was hit to my right, from to my left, and then came to my right, you know, knuckling or whatever. The ball dropped as soon as I saw the ball go on the ground, grab it, throw it home plate, because I thought it was a, you know, regular out of the play. So, you know, it's a tough call. I think it was a tough call for the umpires. I mean, it was not, maybe the angle they got, they didn't see it right, but, you know, could go either way. I don't know, as a ball, it should have made, got on the air and everything would erase it. But, you know, we could have learned from that one in San Francisco. We didn't do it. So, tough loss. That's the bottom line.
How are you feeling?
I'm feeling great. I mean, I'm out there playing. I'm giving the team all I got, and you know, I'm not putting any excuses. I'm going out there to play, and I'm gonna finish the season with the team because that's my goal. You know?
Thank you, sir.
Do you intend to start? Come on. Camera doesn't know you moved.
Calvin Kastein and Brian Jefferson at Olympic Stadium for Hometown Cable. Ron Brown is supposed to be running that camera, but he's roaming around back here, acting like a tourist, Brian.
Good afternoon and good evening, Calvin. Thank you.
We're here for the middle game of the last series of the season here in Montreal. The Atlanta Braves are in town, and we've got a game where the Expos got blown out last night, and tonight they're going against Greg Maddux, one of the premier pitchers in baseball in the last 15 years or so.
Atlanta's got a real strong team. Could be one of the front runners maybe to win it all this year.
Well, they've got an interesting history in recent past. They seem to shine during the season, and it gets to the playoffs. 9 times out of 10, they get knocked out. They don't seem to like to go to the World Series. They seem like they figure it's over when the season is over. They haven't been a playoff team. They made it every year for the last 10, 12 years, but just haven't progressed. I think one year they advanced.
Well, we have to wait and see how the game goes, but Atlanta's got a tough team. Expos are struggling at this time, so.
As we're taping this, Brian, the Expos are one game over 500. And with 2 games left here, they're going to go into their last road trip, hopefully still over 500. But if they lose both of these games, next 2 games of the Braves, they'll go out in that road trip under 500. Last year, for the first time in several years, they were over 500. And it's going to take a big turnaround for them to finish the season over 500.
I think the team this year will be a lot different. A year from now, because they're going to lose a lot of the high-priced players that really can't afford to stay in Montreal. So I'll have to wait and see, but it doesn't look too good for them right now.
As we're taping this on this September 16th, the jury is still out as far as whether they'll be here. You got a guy in the stands, a little distracting here, whether they'll be next year. the people who seem to know what they're talking about, which doesn't include me, but the people I listen to and read about, that it sounds like it's three options that are on the table right now that are most likely to happen. Of course, anything is anything could happen, but the three options appear to be, at this point, the full 81 games next year here in Montreal, 22 games in the San Juan, Puerto Rico, like they did this year, or 22 games in Monterrey, Mexico. The people who seem to be in the know, actually, I think that Monterrey has a better chance than San Juan if they run into a split season like that.
I also heard Las Vegas' name being mentioned, too, within the last day or so on the computer.
Yes, as far as a new ownership for the Montreal Expos, Las Vegas has recently come into the picture, but they would not be ready for 2004. They don't have a ballpark. It takes more than just finding an owner. You got to have a place to play. And that's been part of the problem with, as far as Portland, Oregon, as far as Washington, D.C., and the Northern Virginia area, and I think Charlotte was mentioned for a while. Monterey, I think, bid for the full 81 games, but that isn't going to happen because